revives here tonight. Is that you guys? Is this your thing? Oh, yeah. Revive 40. This is like a nationwide program of some kind?
It is, but we're only in three states.
Three states? Arizona, Kentucky, and Florida. And its ministry is men addicted to porn.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. No, I'm glad you're here tonight. Yeah. Now, if I say something that offends you, please don't leave. Just tough it out. Now, welcome to the Arizona Deliverance Center. Welcome to Phoenix. Welcome to the rain. All right, got a good Bible study for you tonight. YouTubers, love having you here. And after our teaching, we'll have our deliverance service where you'll have a chance to repent and get healed. You all know that deliverance is essentially useless if there is no repentance. Any deliverance ministry that does not center around repentance is a ministry you need to steer completely away from. YouTube, anything, run from it. There is no way to get delivered from demons and stay delivered without repentance and renewing of your mind. If you do not do those two things, you are, as they say on the street, screwed, aren't you? Yeah, huge. Okay? Repentance is the key to serving God. If you're not going to change, your condition is hopeless. It's over. There is no hope for you. None. Well, that's kind of a downer. Actually, it isn't. It's actually a very positive statement. If you repent and change your mind and renew your mind, you're guaranteed miracles from God, and you're going to get healed and delivered. That was actually a positive thing I said. I like positive. All right, let's get going. Got a lot of good stuff for you tonight. Oops. That's the wrong date for that seminar. Sorry about that. It's the fourth Friday of February. Yikes. Here's all my teachings on YouTube. 400 of them if you have something to do in an afternoon. There they are. Just go to youtube.com/houseofhealingaz. And all the teachings are there. All my radio programs are on the website. I've been on the radio for 21 years now. February is my anniversary. 21 years on the radio here in Maricopa County. Just hit the media button and go to streaming radio. Yep, they're all there. I archive all of them. And you can help our ministry out if you switch from Google to Good Search and put in our charity name, Hardcore Christianity, and they'll pay us when you surf the web. Won't cost you anything. I apologize again for the destruction here in the Deliverance Center. We had a major sewer break under the building, and it's been a literal disaster. They jackhammered half the building up. We had to put in all new tile outside. All the cabinets are going in now. The bathrooms were ripped out. Wow. I'm pooped. And I didn't do any of the work. I didn't do any work. I'm exhausted. So we apologize for that. But the bathrooms are working. See, we didn't even have bathrooms. We were sending everybody over to the healing house to go to the bathroom. We didn't even have bathrooms here for how many weeks? Quite a while. Several weeks we didn't have any bathrooms. So it's been a challenge. God send all the money in to fix everything. It's been a miracle. I knew he would. The miracle list, the most important thing you need to have, all of the men at Revival Revive 40 need this list. It's a step-by-step guide to healing and deliverance that works 100% of the time. The problem I have is I can only get about 10% of the people to actually do it. Okay? So if you do these lists, if you're mentally ill, I got one for you. If you're a troubled Christian, got one for you. If you don't do the miracle list, probability of you finding your destiny is very poor. If you have any interest in going into the deliverance ministry, I'd take these 18 classes if I were you. It's on sale in the bookstore. The bookstore's closed. Oh, you want to find out what's going on now? Seven churches of Revelation, like they were written yesterday. Would you like to have that? That's in the bookstore. Bookstore is closed. We have a Zoom service Wednesday night. It's a boomer. Moving of the Holy Ghost, you wouldn't believe. Wednesday nights at 6 o'clock. You can send me an email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com, and I'll send you the code and the password. Here's the Tithely app you can use on your phone if you want to donate off your phone, tithely.com. We have a monthly prayer meeting in the Healing House next door, fourth Saturday of the month at 11 o'clock. And they gather together to pray for our ministry because we need to increase our anointing around here. We're getting a bunch of really sick people coming. I have a deliverance training class the fourth Saturday of every month in the small sanctuary, but we can't do it in there because the small sanctuary is wiped out. So I guess we're going to do it in here temporarily until that room gets fixed. When's that going to happen? I'm not sure. Fourth Saturday of every month, and that's the wrong date too. I got to start proofreading these slides. If you'd like to donate, there's boxes on the doors there. If you feel led to do that, you can donate on the website on the PayPal button. You can listen to my radio programs every morning at 7:30, and as soon as you go on the radio, a phone rings, and that means the show's on. It's at 7:30 Monday through Friday every morning, and then Saturday afternoons and Sunday afternoons go on 10 a.m. Christian radio. I'm also on conservative talk radio at 1100 a.m. I'm on Sunday mornings at 8 o'clock. And then I have a 9 o'clock podcast where I teach the deep things of God. Twitch.tv, just put in HCCADC and boom, 9 o'clock and you're there. YouTubers, remember to set up your ambush team in your church. You only need two or three people to do it. I just had a Zoom service with a bunch of Romanians this week. Trying to get them to set up an ambush team in their church. Romania is, I don't know much about Romania, but that didn't go well. Anyway, you need two or three people in your church. You set up this secret group, and then you start picking off the sick people. It's easy to do. I did it years ago when I was in Scottsdale Dream Center. Is that the mega church over there? I started picking off sick people. It was a month or month and a half. I had so many people lined up on Tuesday night. It was ridiculous. As soon as the word spreads around, boom, everybody comes. As soon as people realize you're getting healed, they show up. Right? Don't forget about our ladies Zoom meeting on Mondays there at 6:30 p.m. Right here. And then the Tuesday night meeting for the ladies is live in this auditorium. It's usually in the small sanctuary, but that's indisposed right now. So Mondays and Tuesdays is ladies night around the Deliverance Center. One's a Zoom and one's an in-person meeting at 6:30, okay? I wrote these three books, one on mental illness, one on divine healing, and the other on Satan. They used to be available, but the bookstores... it's closed. Tonight I'm on YouTube and Rumble. We broadcast live Thursday and Friday night services, 7 o'clock. Live, you can watch it later if you want to. On these platforms, we're also there. And there. And there. Wow. Okay, let's get to the Bible study quickly. We all know there's an Old Testament and a New Testament. We all know there's an Old Testament law and a New Testament law called the Royal Law. We had the Old Testament, which was the law of Moses. We had the New Testament, the Royal Law. Both laws were created and given by the Messiah. He gave the old law on Mount Sinai. He gave the new law at Mount Calvary. If you create a law and it's your law, you have the right, legal right, to change the law, modify the law, or cancel the law because you created it. Genesis 49, here's the prediction. Shebe, the Hebrew word shebe means tribes. The tribes will not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh come. In Hebrew, this means the Messiah of tranquility. He is the lawgiver who gave Moses the law on Mount Sinai. To him shall the gathering of the people be. Old and New Testament. And here's the laws. You have the law of Moses there, and then you have the laws of the New Testament there. Correct? Okay. Now, are you a dispensationalist? I kind of lean that direction. There's some people who don't believe in that, and that they might be right, but I kind of lean that way. Okay? Don't send me an email. I'm just saying, what it could go either way. I'm leaning this way here. And tonight I want to talk about these two dispensations. You notice there's eight of them. There's nine if you put up here eternity past. I left that off, but you can toss it in. There's eternity past, and then you have all these different dispensations. These two here involved Adam, as you know. Right? And there's Noah. And then Father Abraham, number four. And then you had the dispensation of law, Moses. The dispensation of grace, these two we will be discussing today. And then this one is in the future, the dispensation of divine government, where the return of Christ, the millennium, runs the planet, where Jesus runs the planet at some time in the future. The tribulation goes in here somewhere. I didn't put it in. Okay? So I'm only going to talk about these two. There we go. The law and the prophets lasted till when? John. Okay? Since John, the kingdom of God is preached, and every man presses into it. Greek word, biazo. It means to crash into it. To kick the door in. I just answered your questions. Why can't people get healed? Why can't they get delivered? Why are there so many gutless, useless Christians? I just answered your question. What's the answer? They won't crash in. They won't kick the door down. They won't fight and push their way in. You just sit there hoping a blessing will fall in their laps, and it never does. What were they running from? What were they crashing into? The Jews had lived for over 400 years. The law of Moses. Ugh. The law of Moses couldn't save you. It was designed only for one purpose, to show you that you couldn't keep it. The law was a schoolmaster designed to lead you to Christ. The law was only temporary. It served only a temporary purpose, and then it was replaced by the royal law. The dispensation of grace started with the great John the Baptist, history's greatest preacher, the one and only. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers biazo, violence. People wanted to get out of the law and condemnation and death, and they pushed their way into grace. Why can't men get delivered from pornography? They won't fight. They won't push their way in. They don't get vicious. Why do Christians fail all the time? I just answered it. See, the devil will push his way in. He will get vicious. He will fight. He will lie. He will cheat. Christians are too gutless and useless to do it. They just sit back hoping a blessing falls in their lap. And it never does. Christianity in America stinks. Why? Nobody tells the truth about it. This thing's a war. And the probability is, if you don't renew your mind and crash through the gates, you're going to be a casualty. You're going to backslide. You're going to be a loser. Why do you know that, Mike? Well, take a look around. The violent do what? Harpazo. What's that word? That's the Greek word used for the rapture. It means to snatch something. Right? Thessalonians. The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout and the voice of the archangel. Harpazo, to snatch. Okay. This is not harpazo. Mind if I look at that? Notice how gently I picked that up? That's not harpazo. Give me that phone. You see that? See the difference? Brother Mike, what are you doing? Starting a cult? Well, no, I'm not. I'm not a very good cult leader, but the reason your Christian life stinks is because you won't snatch it. Your blessings are behind that door and the devil's blocking it. Boom! You fight through it. And you snatch it. Got a new religion in this. This has always been here. No one reads it. This has been here for 2,000 years or whatever. Nobody reads it. What's my job? To read it to you. That's my job. All the prophets in the law prophesied until John. Biazo. See that bus there? That bus wanted in that building so bad it broke through. What are you supposed to do as a Christian? Bang! You fight your way in. Christians are gutless and useless. Why? They don't hate sin. They don't hate demons. They don't hate sickness. They don't hate the works of Satan. They've learned to adjust to it. You know, they just tolerate it. They just put up. That's fake Christianity. That's what you're supposed to be doing. Crashing through. No man puts a new cloth on an old garment. It will fill up from the old garment and the rent is made worse. Yeah, you put new wine into new wineskins. In the Old Testament, they didn't have any new wineskins. Why? They couldn't get filled with the Holy Ghost. He would only come upon them temporarily, and then he would leave. In the new covenant, you can have the Holy Ghost with you 24/7. What good's that do you? Nothing. It doesn't do you any good at all unless you take advantage of it. Many of you have been in churches where you've seen Christians sitting in the chair there for 25 years. They couldn't pray their way out of a wet paper bag. They're useless. Why? They didn't understand. This is a war. New wineskins get new wine. The old wine, that don't work. They put new wine in new bottles. Both are preserved. Jesus created the law in the Old Testament, and he modified it in the new, didn't he? He changed it, didn't he? Yeah. Murder said that in the Old Testament, but Jesus said, now it's this. If you're angry at somebody without a cause, you are a murderer. In the Old Testament, you had to kill somebody to be guilty of murder. It changed. God changed the law. Now it's a new law. What I just said, man, I think that was filthy. Because if you got anger demons, you're on a routine basis getting mad at people for no reason. You just blow your stack. Which makes you a murderer. Adultery. Old Testament. You had to sleep with somebody. Somebody's wife. You had to sleep with them. That was adultery. You got stoned. New Testament. You commit adultery every time you're on porn. Because you lusted after that male or female on the porn in your heart. You're an adulterer. It's the same as if you slept with them. Whoa. See how Jesus got in trouble? Divorce. My God. Old Testament. Yeah, I don't like you. Here you go. You go. Here's the divorce paper. Take them. Your feet stink. You're too fat. You got bad personality. Go. Huh? New Testament. If you divorce someone for any reason other than fornication, and you marry somebody else, you are an adulterer. Well, Brother Mike, I'm on my third marriage. Well, that means you committed adultery two times after you got divorced. If you didn't get divorced for fornication. If you marry somebody else who got divorced because their spouses had irreconcilable differences, you committed adultery and you got married again. Hey, don't shoot the messenger. I didn't have anything to do with this. I'm just sharing it. You divorced and remarried? Come down and get forgiven for that. Divorce is a pardonable sin. You can be forgiven for a divorce and remarriage. Hello? Yeah. Yeah, swearing changed. Suffering wrong from others changed. The Old Testament beat the crap out of them. Eye for an eye. New Testament. Turn the other cheek. Love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who despitefully use you. The law changed, and the lawgiver changed it. And he's allowed to do that because it's his law. Hating your enemies changed. The new law is what? The words of Christ. That's the new law. You got any red ink in your Bible? You got any red ink in your Bible? Huh? You're reading the new law. The new royal law. Spoken by the lawgiver. Think not that I am come to destroy the law. That's a lot. Oh, throw it down. If you turn on the news sometimes, you'll see a bunch of psychos running around pulling down statues. You ever seen that? Oh, no. Jesus said, I didn't come to pull down the law. I came, or law or the prophets. I came to plurao, fully completed. The law wasn't working. The law only condemned you, couldn't save you. Why? Because you can't keep it. If you break one of the laws, you're guilty of all the laws. A new law had to replace it. A law that would save you. A law of condemnation was changed to the law of mercy. You can get it tonight right here. All things whatsoever that you would men should do to you, you should do to them. This is the law and the prophets. Now he's summarizing the whole law in the new one. Master, which is the greatest commandment? The lawyer asked him, and he said, Matthew 22, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and your soul and your mind. Now, nobody does that. Nobody can do that. But that's our goal. That's our goal. Okay, nobody does that. I never met anybody that did it. But that's always our goal. That's what we're after. You know, that's what we're pushing forward to. This is the first and great commandment. The second one's similar to it, he said. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law. Heaven and earth shall pass away. Now, this word in the King James is a bad one. It actually means, parakamai means to transition. Okay? So, might be similar to a caterpillar, butterfly, or it might be similar to a train picking up these men and going to that city, transitioning from this to that. See that? It doesn't mean pass away like poof, it's gone. No, that's not. It means transition. It wasn't a good translation. But my words never transition. I speak it here. It goes into eternity the same. It's easier for heaven and earth to pass, same Greek word, transition from one condition to another, than for one tittle of the law to fail. Everything he spoke will never fail. That's what's going to happen. Period. These are the words, Luke 24, that I spoke to you, he said. This was after his resurrection. He'd get ready to go home. Remember? He's meeting with the group for the last time. These are the words I spoke to you All these things must be, same Greek word, plerao, completed, come to its fruition, be fully done, which were written in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms concerning me. All right, now let's take a look how Jesus handled the old law and how he transitioned us into the new one. How did he do that? Well, he would break the old law. He'd get in trouble for it. Jesus entered again into the synagogue, Mark 3. There was a certain man there that had a withered hand. And the religious people were watching him. They had their eye on him to see if he would heal on Sabbath so they might. Wow. Accuse him. That's what Satan is. He's the accuser of the brethren. That's what religious people are. Religion is like Ebola. It's a cancer. Religion is the worst thing you can get involved in. Demons use religion to control people. They like to drift them into legalism. Do this, do that, don't do this, don't do that. You're wrong, you're wrong, you're right, you're right. They're controlling you. Jesus turns to the man who has a withered hand. He says, stand out here. He's making an exhibition of the guy. Deliberately. Then he says to them, the religious people, he turns to them and says, is it lawful to do good things on the Sabbath day or to do evil things or bad things? Is it lawful to save lives or kill people? What's lawful on the Sabbath? They couldn't answer him. Why? Well, they were stuck. They were stuck there, so they just clammed up. He looks around on them with what? Orge, anger. I thought Jesus was a pacifist. Well, you know, some ways he kind of was, but when it came to the devil and people not having any compassion on other people, that really bothered him. Why? Because that's the old law. The old law had no mercy on you. You screwed up, tough. You get it. This isn't the new law anymore. He's transitioning out of the old to the new. And now the new law is based on compassion, love. Notice how God is here, though. God does have a temper and he does get angry, but it is very short. Doesn't last long at all, does it? How do I know that? You're sitting here. If it lasted for a while, you wouldn't even be here. Okay? You'd already be dead. And being grieved. Now, this is an interesting word. This root word here, lupeo, see that? That means to be sad or something. Solupeo means to be very exceptionally sad. What was he sad over? The guy's withered hand, can't work, flat broke, living in poverty, he's disabled? No, he was very sad. People who don't have any compassion for other people. Oh, drugging down. First it made him mad, and then he was sad. Which is you be doing the same thing. Oh, man, these people have hard hearts. Who has the hardest heart? Serial killers, spree killers, career criminals, guys in prison. Yeah, they've got hard hearts. But you know who has the hardest heart of all? Christians who live in sin. You would not believe how hard it is to get those people delivered. You wouldn't even believe it. I mean, it's exhausting. You know why? They're just dead inside. Sin's funny. Funny, peculiar. People who are not saved who sin, it's different than a Christian who sins, even if they do the exact same thing. Why? Christian knows better. And as you keep sinning, you know what happens to your conscience? Paul explained it. Sears. Your conscience doesn't work anymore. It doesn't filter out the bad stuff anymore. Stuff that should appall you doesn't bother you anymore. Our entire society is so sick right now, it's beyond comprehension. If you had some people get resurrected from the 1950s and come back right now, they would be in a complete state of shock. That they couldn't believe what was on TV or in the movies. Nobody would believe what's on your phone. Nobody could conceive in their wildest dreams Pornhub. Nobody could believe that. Nobody could believe you had to have a phone, a computer in your hand talking to somebody in India. No one could. It wasn't there back then. I grew up in the 50s. I know. We don't know nothing. If you're a Christian and you're living in willful sin, you are screwed. Your conscience is going to sear, and we're going to go through hell trying to get you just one touch of the Holy Ghost. It's going to be the toughest thing you could ever imagine. You can't imagine it. It is so tough. Their conscience sears, and there's no urgency. You know, they're so used to doing this sin, they should have quit it 5 years ago, and they didn't. And so now they keep doing it, and now their conscience has no horror over it. It's not shocked anymore. Your conscience is not shocked anymore. What am I talking about? Drug addicts, sex addicts, alcoholics, conscience seared. Stuff they did, they would have done in their teens and felt bad about, now doesn't even faze them. They don't even feel it. Nobody wakes up on Monday morning, oh God, I'm a total drug addict. I was fine yesterday, but today, you work up to it, fool. You don't start out a sex addict. Are you crazy? You gotta put some effort into it. Come on, baby, get that sucker going. Push it. You don't become a sex addict overnight. What are you crazy? I've been a counselor for over 40 years. I know exactly what's going on. You gotta work hard to be damned and go to hell. You gotta put some effort into it. You don't wake up a pedophile on Wednesday. Oh, I like kids. Yeah, I'm gonna. No, dude, you gotta work your way into being a pedophile. You gotta keep thinking about it. You gotta keep thinking. You gotta keep desiring it. You gotta keep experimenting with it. You gotta push yourself. Nobody wakes up on Wednesday. Oh, I'm a whore. No, are you crazy? You work your way up to whoredom. You commit it. Adultery a couple times here and there, maybe a teenager, then you have a girlfriend, then you start being planned, then you work up to your sexual insanity. You don't just get it overnight. Everything requires work. Serving God requires work. Serving Satan requires work. You got to work, fool. And if you're a Christian and you're sinning, you're in a hole you can't believe. You're going to have to, diazo, boom, fight your way out. Because you buried yourself. Your conscience later on causes you to giggle or laugh at sin that when you were younger, you would have said, oh, that's not, I shouldn't be doing that. You're laughing at it now. Hello? James chapter 4. James goes over it. Let your laughter be turned to mourning, he said. I mean, when I was a kid, which is before any of you were born, Ricky and Lucy slept in separate beds. Ricky and Lucy, the number one program on the planet, they slept in separate beds and wore full-blown, full-body pajamas. You don't believe me, do you? That would have gone over well if anybody knew who the heck Lucy and Ricky was. I got to get some better material. This is terrible. He said to the man, stretch forth your hand. He's making a demonstration of him. See, he pulled him out front. Why? To make demonstration? No, he was transitioning out of the Old Testament. And now this is the New Testament. Mercy. You couldn't get mercy under the Old Testament. Did you do it? Yeah. Boom. Judgment. God never planned on keeping that system. It was always temporary because that's not his heart. He likes to help people. He enjoys it. Oh, yeah. And he's ready to do it tonight, too. You'll be surprised. You'll see him helping people left and right tonight. That's what he really likes. That gets him going. Judgment, no. Mercy rejoices against judgment. Boom, his hands grew back. He's hanging around the pool, right? Remember this story, John 5? Looks over there, sees a guy just laying there decades. Gets healed. Pick up your bed and go start walking. Oh, you made a mistake. There it is. Did it on Sabbath. Oops. Jesus committing a bunch of sins. Jesus is a sinner. No, there was no sin there. He was transitioning us out of that. Thou shalt love your neighbor as yourself. That's the all the law and the prophets. What does that look like? This. He gets off his cot. Healed. This. Withered hand. Old. New. New wineskin. The man departed and ratted on him. This guy would have been perfect in any church now. He'd fit right in. You can't imagine how many Christians who have had years of blessings from God, one bad thing happens to them, and they turn on him. They blame him for something. They file complaints with him. They ask why. And they forget all the miracles they already got. They forgot them all. They become consumed with their current crappy situation. Please don't look at me like you don't know what I'm talking about. You know exactly what I'm talking about. This guy gets healed. He's walking around with his cot. And a bunch of religious people start ragging on him. And he rats Jesus out. You would have thought the guy would have said, what's it to you? Well, you're carrying your cot around on the Sabbath, you idiot. I don't care. I was told to do that by God. Heal me. I'm going to put him up here and put these religious people down. He didn't do that. He swapped it. He went back to religion and ratted on Jesus. Well, what happened? What? Absolutely. What happened is normal. If you start moving in the Holy Spirit, the Christians will turn on you. If you decide to have a healing or deliverance ministry, I hope you do. Hey, you're going to get some blowback. From who? Drug-crazed sinners? No, they don't care whether you go in the ministry of healing and deliverance. Christians will turn on you. They'll kick you out. They wanted to murder him. Says it right there, slay. Greek word, apateno, to murder. Jesus said, my Father works and I work. Wow. Now that sounds like a very inflammatory statement. Turned out to be, but what was he doing there? What is work? They thought more to kill him. They were even madder. Why? Because he broke the Sabbath and he said that God was his Father. See, the way the Jews, if you go back 2,000 years or so, 2,500 years, if you was a Jew, your thoughts, your background in your head is the nation of Israel is here and our Father is God over the nation of Israel. That's the old covenant. The new covenant is when you become a born-again Christian, God is your personal Father. It's you and him. You're his son, personally. Not America, Europe, Asia, Israel. Now it's personal. Old wineskins. The Jews flipped their wick. Luke 13, one day Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues on the, oh boy, here we go again. More trouble. Can't you pick another day? No, he did it deliberately. Transition out. In. Behold, there was a woman there that had a spirit of infirmity. She was sick for 18 years. She was bowed together. What is that? Syncope. That's the medical term, kyphosis. She was bent forward like that. Have you ever seen old people at the care center, kind of with that humpback thing? And they kind of look up like that and looking up at you. That's what she had. But what was fascinating about it was caused not by a medical condition, caused by a spirit. The same thing that causes sex addictions, alcoholism, drug addiction, cancer. Caused by a spirit. She's humped over in the service. When Jesus saw her, he called to her. He said to her, woman, you're loose from your infirmity. Remember that? That demon flew out of there and she stood right up. That's not medically possible. You can't instantly stand up from rheumatoid arthritis, scoliosis, kyphosis, whatever it is. No. What's the best way to stop being an addict of anything? You get the spirit of addiction out and the person can recover. You leave the demon in, they struggle the rest of their lives. They never change. Can they stop drinking or smoking or whatever? Yeah, they can, but without getting the spirit out of there, if they would have to have a very strong mind and be a strong person and be determined to do it, see? And so in rehab programs, what they try to do is they try to pump the person up mentally and emotionally and try and get them to kind of be a stronger person. You fight that addiction. Fight it off. And here's how you do it. We'll give you some behavior modification techniques. We'll give you some mind control techniques. We'll get you to memorize truckloads of scriptures till it's falling out of your ears. We'll get you to repeat these phrases, and we'll get you to sing a bunch of songs. And does it work? Yeah, sometimes. Small percent. If that spirit's out of there that's pushing you to do it, person recovers. It's going to be a tough night. I didn't get any amens on that at all. We're in trouble here, folks. He laid his hands on her. What? Laying hands on people. That's crazy. The demon flew out. Boom. The ruler of the synagogue, the religious kooks, they're everywhere out there. Okay? You go with the Holy Ghost, and I'm telling you, Christians will turn on you. I'm warning you. Okay? If you play along with the Christian system, sit here, eat there, go here, stop there, sit there, stand there, sing there, read that there, donate there, go to Golden Corral. If you go through that system, they'll accept you. You start breaking out with the Spirit of the Lord, somebody's going to come looking for you. You better do what? Count the cost. The guy got mad at Jesus. Can you imagine seeing this scenario? This poor woman, he doesn't have any compassion for her at all. Hardness of heart is what you get if you're in religion. Religion generates hard hearts because it tells you the people who don't conform to your religion, there's a problem with them. They're jacked up because they're not doing it your way. That's the plague of religion. This guy's mad at Jesus Christ. Right after that gal got healed, he should have been leading the praise service, right? That's what I do when somebody gets healed. This person got healed, I have them march back and forth leading the praise service. I've done it 50 times down here. Did you just get healed? You're in charge of praise. This guy here gets mad at him. What are you healing that old woman? She's a piece of crap. What about my religion, doofus? Can you believe this? Hard to believe. People are this stupid. And then he turns around to the people. He gets mad at Jesus, and then he starts barking at the congregation because he doesn't want to lose them. There's 6 days you do this and that, and then you do it on that day. Then you do it this way. Then you do it that way. I'm the ruler here. Brother, he got reamed out, didn't he? Remember that story? Anybody read that story? It was really fascinating. Anyway, Jesus ripped the guy. Luke 14, it came to pass. Jesus went into the house of one of the chief Pharisees. That's a guy on the Sanhedrin. That's one of the big mucky mucks in Israel, chief Pharisees. And the chief Pharisees there, then it all broke down in ranks. Yeah. Apostle Paul was up here, one of the big guns. And he goes to that guy's house, and the place is loaded with lawyers of the law, doctors of the law, and Pharisees. They're all there because they know who Jesus is, and they're fascinated, and they want to watch him because they're trying to screw him over. They want to catch him doing something against what? So they can stone him. They were watching him. See, if you learn to move in the Spirit, if you start doing what God really wants you to do, then people are going to start watching it. How come Christians can't get healed and delivered? They never learned biazo. They don't know how to fight. Because every time you take one step toward God, the demons took two steps toward you. And an alarm goes off in the spirit world. It's the holy shoot alarm. This person is moving toward God. Stop him! What are his assets? Well, he likes a little porn. He drinks when he gets under stress. He loses his temper around these type of people. And so the demons then start bringing those kind of people in to piss him off. Then they arrange a meeting here, and then they... And because Christians are so gutless, they don't recognize that they're in a war, and they won't fight their way through using their faith and the Word of God. And if they did, they would overcome 100% of the time. But they don't do that. They start caving in. They get blowback. Have you ever watched a TV show, a cable show or whatever it is, called Naked and Afraid? You ever heard of that? I'm not making this up. I watched that show the other night, and my mouth hit the floor. They took two people, and they take them out to places where people are not supposed to be. Okay, there's a reason they call it a jungle, and a desert, and a deserted island. Okay, that's why they name it that, because people are not supposed to be there. They're not supposed to be there. So the two people, a guy and a gal, are on separate boats, and they're traveling to this horror show, wherever they're dumping them. And on the way there in the boat, both of them are talking to the camera, and they're just telling them what great survivalists they are, oh, how they can endure great pressure. Oh, they're tough. They're tough. They're ready for this adventure. They think it's an adventure. Oh, then they get to the destination. They're looking around. Then they got to take their clothes off. One of them's kind of a pervert, and he goes, "I don't mind being naked. No problem there. There you go." The other one's going, "God, I don't feel real comfortable taking my clothes off, but I don't know. This is a challenge, and I got to overcome this challenge. I got to meet the challenge. I take my pants off." So the two morons head into the jungle or the desert or God only knows what, naked, with no shoes. Okay? Most people can't make it from the Deliverance Center to the parking lot without shoes on. Can't make it out there. They get dropped in the Amazon jungle with no shoes on. They're right out of the gate. You know, these two people. Several fries short of a Happy Meal. Both of them nuts. But you notice they get off that boat, man, they're full of hope. Did you ever watch that show? Oh, they can't wait. They can't wait to get. They want to get out there and get that sucker done. Yeah, I want to be a survivalist. I want an adventure. 24 hours later, they're falling apart. 48 hours later, they're looking at the other person with raw hate in their eyes. He's not doing his job. She's not carrying her load. We can't get a fire started. We don't have any water. Hey, Einstein, you just got dropped in a desert, and you thought you were going to run out there with a drinking fountain? But you know what happens on that show? It's tremendous psychology. It's really interesting. Human beings, by nature, release who they really are under pressure. And the person on the boat that has their clothes on, heading out to the pits of hell, that's not the real person. The real person comes out when they're out of water, out of food, and tired of that other person. There's nobody else around. Why do you think God allows you to go through these things? He's trying to help you look inside yourself. The real person never comes out. Just sitting here, relaxing, watching the ball game. That's a totally different person. You can't win any spiritual battles while you're taking a nap. You got to learn to overcome, Revelation 2 and 3. You must be trained to be an overcomer. In order to do that, you got to have something to overcome. To overcome things means you have to face adversity. Why? So the real person in you will come out and you can see the flaws of your personality and your mind so God can fix them for you. This has turned into a poor Bible study. Let me get back to this then. They were watching him, see? And it says, behold, there was a certain man which had the dropsy. What is that? Hudropikos. That is an elephantitis. Have you ever seen somebody with elephantitis? Their calves swell out to here. Well, it's a terrible disability. They can't walk. Their hands are like, it's edema on steroids. Essentially. And he's sitting there in front of the Pharisees and the lawyers, and Jesus turns to them, not the disabled man, and says, is it lawful? What's he doing there? Transition out. In. For the law and the prophets were until since then the glory's preached. What's that look like? Loving your neighbor as yourself. Loving the Lord God with all your heart. Loving your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who sin. That's the new law. What's that look like? It looks like this. See the guy with dropsy? He says, look, I'll show you what the new law looks like. I'm the lawgiver, so I can cancel, change, or modify any law I want because I created it. I'm creating it right now. Check this dropsy guy out. It's mercy. They held their peace again. Now here's something really interesting. Epilobanomai means to grab the guy and yank him. Now, come here. He physically grabs the guy. Probably because he can't stand up. I'm guessing. It doesn't say that. I just filled that in. But something caused him to grab the dude. He wasn't laying hands on him like he did the woman with the spirit of infirmity. No, that's not the word. He grabs him. Then heals him. Then he lets him go. Can you imagine that? If it was a lower extremity, that thing just went down like that, right in front of everybody. People had been flabbergasted. Christ the healer. The new law. Not the old. Leprosy. Everybody knows what that is, right? Numbers chapter 19. The law of God required what? Listen, you can't touch a leper. That's against the law of Moses. That's a violation of the law. If you've got leprosy, I am not allowed to touch you under that law. Correct? Leviticus 13. Listen, if you have leprosy, you're not allowed to be here. You're not allowed to come to the deliverance center. You're out there. You don't come in here. I can't even shake your hand if you have leprosy. It's against the law of God. Right? If you touch them, you're defiled. You're defiled if you touch somebody that's got leprosy. I'm defiled. It's against the law. Thus saith the Lord, do not touch a leper. Wait a minute here. Oh, I know. We're under a new law here. There came a leper begging him and kneeling down to him. And he says, if you will, you can make me clean. This is the Greek word thalo. I've said that before. I'm going to get new batteries in this thing. Thalo means I want to. The leper said to him, if you want to, you could make me clean. He knew he could, but he wasn't sure he wanted to. See, that's the problem with born-again Christians. They pray prayers that are never answered. Why? Because because they're not sure God wants to do it. They know he can do it. That's why they offered up a Mickey Mouse prayer. Lord, if you want to, Lord, if it be thy will, yeah. Bunch of church crap comes out. No answered prayer. If God told you that was his will, then if you ask him, if it be thy will, you're praying unbelief and your prayer goes down the toilet. Right? If God said, here, this is the way it is, and I go, are you sure that's the way it is? I'm actually saying I don't believe you. I say, are you sure? It means I don't believe you. I'm questioning you. As soon as you do that, boop, your prayer is gone. No answer. It's praying in unbelief. You can't do that. Wipes out your prayer, right? If you want to, you can make me clean. He looks at the leper and goes, hey, this guy's being sincere. He wants to know if I want to heal him. And Jesus said, moved with compassion, oh, man. Old law, out. Don't touch him. You're gone. Leave your family, your friends, your job, everything, it's gone. A new law. Is somebody following this? Jesus broke the old law he had created and modified it and created a new one, and he can do that legally because he created the law. It's his law. I have no authority whatsoever to adjust any of God's laws because I'm just a person. I ain't got nothing. He created the law. Therefore, he can modify it or cancel it if he chooses. Jesus, don't touch him. Doubting Thomas yelling at him. Don't touch him, Lord. You're going to get defiled. No, Thomas, dude, you're doubting all the time. That's the old law. I'm trying to train you, Thomas. This is the new law. See, if you were a drug addict in the Old Testament or porn addict or whatever, and you trashed your parents, you know what they did with you? Stoned you! See these guys right here? They'd all be dead. Why? Thou shalt not dishonor thy mother nor thy father. Every addict, no matter what the addiction is, always trashes the people who love them. They all do it. I hope you're listening, because the mother-father curse was carried over from the old law to the new one. If you trashed your parents, the devil would put a curse on you. You know what happens when you get a curse? Everything starts going bad. Broken relationships, no money, layoffs, foreclosures, life screwed up, brains jacked up. That's called a curse. And you got it when you trashed your mom and dad. You lied to him. Yeah, I'm going into rehab, Mom. I promised this time. You weren't going into rehab, and you knew you weren't. Yeah. You lied to your parents. Now, if you lie to your neighbor, that's bad, but your parents, that's, don't do it. Because you're going to get cursed. You know what's going to happen to you? No life, no marriage, no family, no career, no retirement. Your life rhymes with the word clucked. At this altar tonight, you're going to fix that with God. You trashed your parents, we're going to get that curse off you right here. You know, I mean, creation, the curse automatically falls off. No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. You got to ask for forgiveness for that. You got to apologize if they're still alive. You got to get that curse off of you. You got to repent. Then you know what you're going to get if you repent? I want to. I want to help you. I want to heal you. I want to deliver you. I want you to be healed. I want you clean. Alo, I want to. As soon as he spoke, immediately the leprosy departed and he was cleansed. There you go. Jesus broke the law to implement the new law. The leper went home to his family. I'd have paid real money to see that reunion. You know what? I would love to have been a little fly on the wall watching him walk into his wife and kids. Got on your nose when he last time you saw him. No job, no money. Homeless. Am I getting too far out tonight for you guys? This doesn't seem to be working. Now, Jesus said, hey, listen, don't tell anybody about this. Go show yourself to the priest. Why do you want him to do that? Because he had to implement the law of Moses? No. He wanted to show the priest, hey, the Messiah is here. That's what he does. There's a new sheriff in town. The old out, the new in, new wineskins, not the old. This is a good Bible study. You're missing something great here. Let's talk. Let me get off this as quick as I can. This is uncomfortable, but... This is not what I normally teach about. Okay, this is an aberration. But listen, in the Old Testament, okay, blood stuff had laws about it. Okay. Seven days. Unclean. Blood. Okay? Could be from menstruation, could be from cancer, could be whatever. Whatever it is. Doesn't say. If a woman have an issue of blood many days out of her time of her separation, if it run beyond the time of her separation, all the days of the issue, she is separated, she is unclean. Out. Out of the camp. Out of the tribe. Leave. You're unclean. Blood. Out. With me? That's the law of Moses. Thus saith Jehovah. You're out. Period. That's it. Sorry for the pun. Right there. Right there. You're out. You're gone. Boom. That's the law. Wait a minute. We're transitioning into a... There's a new sheriff in town. All your days of uncleanness, you're gone. You're unclean. You're out the dope. Anybody who touches anything you touched is unclean. What? Wow, this is a big deal. There were strict laws about blood issues. Okay? You couldn't even touch her. If she sat over there, you can't touch that chair. You're unclean. Law. No mercy. Out. Wait a minute here. Wait a minute. I sense a new law. Matthew 9. Behold, there was a woman with disease with an issue of blood. 12 years. She came up behind him and touched the hem of his garment. She said, if I just touch the garment, wait a minute, that's against the law. You aren't allowed to touch a priest's garment when you're having blood issues? You're out under that law, not under this one. Mercy, mercy overcame blood issues. So if I just touch his garment, I'll be made whole. Wow. This is a tough woman. This was a desperate woman. You know why Christians can't get healed or delivered? Anybody know? They're not desperate. They want a quick fix to their healing. My back hurts. Can you pray for me? What's the root cause of that back? I don't want to go. Just pray for flip. They want you to flip a light switch and fix them. I'm an addict. Click. Oh, no, I'm not. Okay. No, it doesn't work like that. It didn't work like that. When she was at home, she was alone. When she was hiding wherever she was, she says, you know, so I've heard about Jesus, and I know, and I think if I could just touch his garment, I'll be made whole. You know what? Did her no good. She wasn't healed. You're not healed either. You might have a rack of good intentions. Oh, I want to minister here. I want to help here. I want to sacrifice. Who cares? Nothing happened to her until she did something. See, faith without works is dead. Your faith is useless until you put it in action. You have no chance of being healed. Sitting home saying, God loves me and God's going to heal me. God can heal me. Amen. Amen. Come here for a minute. Bend over. Get out the door. Make your move. Do something. That triggers the Holy Ghost. Hoping and wishing and thinking about it. That's only the start. That's not how you get a miracle. It doesn't work like that. She got up. She staggered down to the street. She had to push her way through the crowd. Did she time it perfectly and the tassel just flopped up in her face? What are you, stupid? She dove for that tassel! Desperate to live. Push her way through the crowd. Fight her way in. That's how you get healed. That's how you get delivered from addictions. That's how you get your mind back. You fight your way in. And God honors you and takes every step you take with you. What's the best way to get a miracle? Well, here's the worst way. I think I'll sit on my fanny for a while. I think I'll just sit here and bleed. No, you get up! You don't understand, the woman with the issue of blood had to be healed. She had to be healed. It was the law of faith. God set the law of faith up. You fulfill the requirements. Your healing's guaranteed. You've got your miracle. You've got it. Sitting around collating is going to get you nowhere. She wasn't even supposed to be there. Nobody wanted her there. Why? She was unclean. She bumped into everybody in that crowd. She made them all unclean. According to the law. Mercy said, sweetie, keep coming. You're almost there. Born again Christians never get their prayers in. Why? Because they go 2/3 of the way and they poop out. I'm discouraged. Your miracle was 15 steps away. Over there. You stopped here. Jesus turned on her. She touches him from behind. He turns. Who touched me? Peter goes, hey, Lord, I was talking to Thomas over there, and he explained it to me. All these people were touching you. There's people all over the place. You've had 5,000 people touch you today. Thomas verified it for me. It's about 5,000. You see, touching somebody means nothing. Touching with faith triggers the Holy Ghost. He got one touch in that whole crowd. One touch. He only felt one. He'd been touched hundreds of times, but he only felt one of them. No. If that didn't land, you're what we call an apostate. And that should have worked. Daughter. Oh, baby. Listen to me. There's a new sheriff in town. You get mercy now. You don't get the law. Father wants to heal you. Jesus said, I only do those things I see my Father doing. On that day, you know what he saw Father doing? Healing a woman with cervix cancer, dying. There it is, made whole. Oh, dead bodies. What's this all about? Well, under the old law, Jesus kept breaking it. I don't know what was wrong with him. He must have been a terrible sinner. No, he wasn't sinning at all. He was transitioning us and getting us to see with real human experience how this transition proceeded and how it progressed and what it looked like. This is what it looks like. This is what mercy looks like. The dropsy guy. The menstrual gal. The disabled old woman. This is what mercy looks like. I'm showing it to you. I'm not just telling you about it. It was against the law to touch a dead body, man. You're not allowed to do that unless it was a relative. Okay? You guys aren't related, are you? So if this guy dies, you're not allowed to touch him. You're unclean. You can't even touch him. You can't touch his bedclothes. He died in bed. You cannot. Are you his brother? You can touch him. But not. That's the law of God. The law. Jehovah said that. Thus saith the Lord. Don't touch a dead body, period. Or you're unclean. The Lord said to Moses, speak to the priests and the sons of Aaron and tell them this. Hey. You can't get defiled. You can't touch dead people. Jehovah said that's against the law. You can't do that. Correct? One day, Brother Jairus from the synagogue comes running out to the street. His daughter's that close to dying. Remember the story? Isn't that a great story? He's desperate. They've done everything they could for her. And he hears about Jesus rolling down the streets of Jericho. There he goes. He bolts. Any father who loved his daughter would have done it. Wouldn't they? Almost any. Let me say almost any so I don't get in trouble there. But he runs down and he said, Lord, my daughter's dying. She may even be dead at this moment. Come to my house. Come to my house. Lay your hands on her. She'll be well. Oh, wait, I can't do that. That's against the law. If she's dead, I can't. Jesus said, lead the way. You're not following that? Oh, man. Christians can't get their prayers answered. Why? They don't pray like Brother Jairus did. He came with total desperation. And all he said was a few words, bang, you get your prayer answered. Lead the way. Yes. If you pray like this, dear Lord, you know what I'm thinking? I'm not sure. You imbecile. You're getting nothing from God. Brother Jairus was totally desperate. My baby, that's my only daughter. My wife cranked out 7 or 8 boys. I'm tired of boys. I always wanted a girl. I always wanted her to be my girl. And now she, the brothers are all fine. She's dying. Brother Jairus was in desperation mode. Why do you think God allows Christians to face disasters? He's trying to teach you. Everybody who prays with desperation gets a miracle. Not under the old law. They stoned you. We're not in the loop. We're over here now. Yeah. You lead the way. Then suddenly Brother Jairus is engulfed with church people. The people from the church caught him. Hey, don't bother this teacher anymore. Your daughter just died. He turns around with panic on his face. He stares at Jesus, looking at him with sheer terror. And here's these words, keep on believing. Brother Jairus looks at the church people. They all went like this. He looked over and saw that. You as a born-again Christian are going to face that every day of your life. You're either going to let the demons tell you no, or the Holy Ghost tell you yes. And you decide, not God. You get a miracle, that's up to you. Brother Jairus makes the right decision. He gets rid of the church people and he goes with God. They come walking into the house. Hey, what are you guys mourning about? They start laughing at him. She's not dead. You know what? When you have doubt and unbelief, you know what the Spirit of God's going to do to you? I hate to be so hard about this, but you're going to get escorted out. You're not in the club with doubt. Brother Mike's kind of harsh. No, it's the law of faith. When you doubt, it wipes out your prayer. These people were doubting, so you know what he did? He escorted them out. You're out. And take your if it be prayer with you. You're out. He goes in with the mom and dad. A couple of the disciples. They go in there with him, right? What happened? He touches the girl, takes her by the hand. And they said, wait a minute, you just broke the law. You sent Jesus God needs to repent. He's breaking the no. I gave that law. Now I am modifying it. It's my law. I am the lawgiver, he said. Dead bodies, not with mercy. Jesus heading on foot again, all kinds of crowds following him. Everywhere he went, big crowds. They come to the thriving metropolis of Nain. Small little town, nobody there. You know, similar to Nazareth. You know, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Nain, what is that? He comes near the gate of the city and there was a dead man being carried out, the only son of his mother. She was a widow, okay? So this woman is what? Typical born-again Christian? No, this woman is now having to live on welfare. And what was the welfare system back then? The families. She had no husband. Almost all jobs were men, for men. Most of the jobs, most of them, were manual labor jobs. Women did women-type stuff at home. She had no husband, no income. Now, her only son, who is going to replace her husband, is dead. She's gone. Nothing. She's going to have to live off a relative's generosity for the rest of her life. Right? She has no husband. Now she has no son. When the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her. Once again, a feature of the new covenant. Compassion. He tells her, stop crying, sweetheart. He touches the soros, the coffin. Well, that's again, what? The Pharisees needed to take Jesus aside and explain the law to him. Listen, what's your name? Yahshua? Okay. Now, this is the law. And this is what the law says. Okay, you need to stop breaking the law. Jesus said, I'll get back to you on that. But in the meantime, I got a compassionate, broken soul to heal. You guys can talk to the hand. You weren't allowed to touch a dead body. You can't touch the coffin. You can't touch their clothes unless you're a relative. Jesus wasn't a relative. He didn't know them from low to coal. But Father knew exactly who they were. I only do those things I see my Father doing. That day, he saw his Father resurrecting a dead boy. Young man. Wake up. Then he takes the kid. Hands him over to mom. Wow. What a story. Typical for the living Savior. Typical story. Out of the law into grace. Confirmation. Let me ask you some hard questions here real quick as we close. Are you following the royal law, the new law? Are any of these a feature of your life now since you've been a Christian? It was up here really bad, but now it's like down here, you've improved a lot, right? You became a Christian years ago and your anger was here, now it's gone down here. It's not gone. Huh? We just went over all these things in the Bible study. Are you a murderer tonight? Well, if you're blowing your stack at people, that demon needs to come out of there tonight. Because Paul warned us as Christians, not sinners, Christians, grieve not the Holy Spirit of God. Same Greek word, lupeo. Don't make him sad. Then he said something else even more frightening. Quench not the Spirit. Sabenemi is a Greek word. It means to extinguish, like you'd put out a match. It's gone. I was in a service one time. I don't know if I ought to tell this. I was in a service one time at a big church, and to my utter surprise, the pastor there preached a really anointed message. That was impressive. And he had an altar call. I thought, man, I'm going to go down there. Because I kind of felt the spirit. And I thought, well, this atmosphere feels good. So I thought maybe I could pray for somebody. Who knows? So I went down. And some other guy was down there. There was about 25, 30 people down there. And this one guy down there gave this prophecy. And it was something similar to this. Thus saith the Lord. The Lord commands you to repent or judgment will fall upon you. Or something like that. That thing just cranked out. I'm not even kidding you. I could actually feel the total atmosphere at that altar change. It felt like the Holy Ghost just poof. Like gone. I mean, I couldn't believe it. I'd never seen anything like that before. I didn't know what was going to happen next, so I bolted. Yeah, I don't want to get caught in some kind of a cult thing, but the point I'm trying to make is if you blow your stack at somebody, you start cursing, you start losing your temper, you start doing this, you trick out on porn for 20 minutes, you're quenching the spirit. You know, quenching a spirit, a candle. That's what that word means. Subenemy. Yeah. Your job as a born-again Christian is to do the opposite. You are to be blooming with the Spirit of the Lord. Being used as a channel and a vessel to administer the dispensation of grace. See if you're in the law. Listen, what are you wearing today? Well, put your hat on, get a beanie, wear this shirt. It's got to be this color. Got to wear these shoes. You got legalism kills people's souls. Freedom saves them. Did you get divorced and get remarried? And you didn't get divorced for fornication reasons? Oh, that was a sin. Come down here. God will forgive you. Divorce is a pardonable sin. There's only one unpardonable sin, and it's so bad I'm not going to mention it. Divorce is not one of them. Well, I've been married. I'm like you, Brother Mike. I got a whole sling of wives and husbands. Yeah, come down here. Just repent of it. I divorced my first wife. You did? Why'd you do that? She wouldn't cook and clean. Okay. That was a sin. You're not allowed to get a divorce unless it was fornication involved. And if you got married to somebody else, they sinned marrying you. You sinned marrying them. Where do you get these cockamamie ideas, Mike? On the Sermon on the Mount? Brother Mike's having a moment of pride. Listen, divorce is forgivable, but you got to ask for it. Loving your enemies, you still have any bitterness or resentments against somebody? They robbed you, they stole from you, they raped somebody, they did this horrible things to you. Did they? You got to forgive them. You have no choice. You can do it here. You can get healed here. See, if you won't forgive, that's putting you under the old law. An eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth. If you get the old law, you're going to get judgment. You don't want judgment. You don't want justice. Well, I got screwed. I deserve justice. If you get justice, that means you should die and go to hell. That's where you belong. You didn't get justice, sir. You got mercy. You don't want justice. You don't need justice. For all the law and the prophets were until John. And from that moment, everyone presses into it. Beyonzo, they crash through to get mercy. Brother Mike, I don't know. I'm kind of an introvert. I'm shy. Well, repent of it. Just come down here and repent of it. I don't know if you turned on the news lately, but the United States has been lost. It's going to hell in a handbasket, and it can't be stopped. We don't need anybody in the church who's shy. What God needs is people who will crash through the door and take it by force. You got to learn to MMA the Lord, right? That's what happened in the Old Testament. He wrestled with God until the morning. He said, hey, let go of me. I got to go. I'm not letting you go until I get my miracle. You prayed for five minutes and quit. I'm tired. No, you're not tired. You're gutless. You got a demonic yellow streak down your back. You need to rip that thing off tonight and fight for your miracle from God. That's what you need to do. Every man presses into it. Why? They wanted to get out of the law and condemnation, damnation and hell. They wanted mercy, grace, and forgiveness. So they blew through the door to get it. That's how you get a miracle. Are you bleeding tonight? You just press your way through the crowd. You fight your way and you die for that castle. Then God moves. I think I'll sit at home and call the prayer chain. Call the prayer chain. You need a bunch of Mickey Mouse people praying for you. You need to stand up and push your way in. Yeah, prayer chain. Almost everybody that gets on the prayer chain dies. Did you know that? Everybody calls a prayer chain. Oh, somebody got cancer. So I got cancer. Will you pray for my uncle? 2 months later, he's dead. Yeah, we're praying for him. Praying. Listen, after you've prayed, then you make your move. You don't keep praying. You step out. Brother Jairus was at home praying. Yahweh, Yahweh, Yahweh. She's dying. And then Yahweh showed up. Downtown Jericho, the eternal God was moving through. Like, I'll just pray here. I can't leave my daughter. But what? He blew out of that house like Carl Lewis and Hussein Bolt. He was downtown in seconds. Why? Desperate people get miracles from God. They don't act like church people. Church people get nothing. They just get stupider, fatter, and lazier. The kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. Any of these still on your list? You say, oh, no, I did that. Well, I mean a little bit on your list. I'm assuming you've improved in almost all these areas. That's my guess. But the rest of them have to go. Let's pray then. Father God, Lord, I've done the best I could tonight, and as you know, that's never good enough. The Holy Spirit's the only person that can help us. I'm looking to Jesus, the author and finisher of my faith. Father, I'm asking you right now for mercy. I left the law behind, and I reached for those things which are before me. I reached for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus, my Lord. That's what Brother Paul taught me to do. He told me to do that. He said, those things that are behind me, I let those go. Yes. Yes. I see it now. Brother Mike's right. Those scriptures are right. I see why Christians don't get an answer to prayer. They're not kicking the door in. They're not fighting. They're not like that lady with the issue of blood. She was desperate. She fought for her life. Brother Jarius fought for her daughter's life. He sacrificed for her. He pushed his way in. I see why Christianity is a failure in the United States. I see why it's so bad. People are too comfortable. People are too indifferent. People are too casual. Nobody is crushing their way in to the kingdom of God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for changing your law from the Old Testament law that would have damned my soul to hell. And I was fortunate enough to have found an altar years ago and cried my way into mercy. Thank you for mercy. Thank you for grace. I don't want justice, Lord. I want mercy. And that's what you gave me. And tonight, the demons tormenting my friends in this building tonight, I'm putting you on notice. You're going to get your face kicked in about 10 minutes. So you get ready to get it. You're going to get it. The Holy Ghost, the one and only, will show up tonight. The devil's in deep trouble here. Because some people here, not all, some of you, heard those scriptures, and you realized that you're going to have to kick that door in. The door to healing and deliverance, the door to miracles, isn't a door that will just open because you look at it or you wave at it. You're not a magician. That door has to be kicked in. Your sick children aren't going to get healed unless somebody kicks the door in for them. They're not going to do it because they're pregnant again and living with somebody again and on drugs again and they're drunk again. So that's the end of your daughter. No! Not after tonight. Somebody who loves your daughter or your son is going to kick that door in. Somebody is going to get off their tush and move and fight for her life or his life. Somebody in your family you love is sick. They're going to die. No! No, somebody's going to kick the door in for them. The kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. I just had a revelation. I didn't understand what a true intercessor was. I thought an intercessor was what the people at church told me they were. They were wrong. Intercessors are door kickers. Intercessors smash through to get a miracle from God. Intercessors fight for the lives of the people dying in front of them. They don't just sit and pray somewhere. No. No. Well, I'm shy and I'm an introvert. I'm repenting tonight, Lord. I'm going to ask you to forgive me of that. That is a curse that needs to be broken off. And when my mother was shy, my dad, I don't care who was shy. We got to get that broke off you tonight because you are to be a warrior for God. That's who you're supposed to be. Somebody's got to repent. Come on down here if you're ready to repent. No deliverance will last. No deliverance is permanent without repentance. I don't care what the guy on YouTube told you. I don't care what the guy, the prophet or the apostle at the service. No, there aren't any apostles. Thank you. There aren't any apostles or prophets here tonight. Okay, this is just a bunch of real people getting together. I don't need any apostles or prophets. Yeah, I need people that are looking for a miracle from God. I'm looking to repent of your sin, of your attitudes, of your anger, of your lust. You have a lust for what? Food. Okay, you use food as a comfort. You're going to repent of it tonight. You're going to repent of it tonight. The devil's trying to give you diabetes and heart disease by getting you to eat when you're anxious. You eat when you're scared. You eat when you're afraid. That's a spirit. That's an unclean spirit in your body. That's an unclean spirit. You got a porn problem. You got a porn problem. That's a spirit. That's a spirit of lust. That thing's got to come out at any cost. Okay? At any cost. He will ruin the rest of your life. He will ruin the rest of your life. He will ruin the rest. He will back off of you deliberately and give you a break temporarily. Then he will rush you. He will rush you. He will gang stalk you. And suddenly you'll be back on porn, back on drugs, back on alcohol. Then he'll back off for a little bit, giving you an illusion that you're better. It's an illusion. So he can stay in there. It's an illusion. Satan, I command you. Come on. Satan, I command you to loose me tonight. I am not going to sit and pray weak prayers anymore. I'm going to kick that door in. I'm going to push my way in. This is my night. This is my night. Say it. Satan, I command you. I command you, you foul spirit. Come out of my body right now in Jesus' mighty name. Come out of my body in Jesus' mighty name. Anger, lust, laziness, food addiction. Come out in Jesus' holy name. Put your hands on your body. One on your chest, one on your tummy. Put your hand on your body. Come out in Jesus' name. Come out, you pervert. You sex pervert, come out of there. Get out. Get out of my body right now. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Come out right now. Hurry up. Come out right now. Come out right now. Get out of my body, you spirit of lust. You sexual pervert. You spirit of sexual perversion. I command you to come out of me right now. In the name of Jesus Christ. Come out right now. Come out right now. Come out. Yeah, a yawner just came out. Did you see that? Yeah, sure did. Come out of my body right now. Hurry up. Satan, I command you to come out. I command you to lose your hold on me. Demon of mental illness, I curse you. Come out of my head. Get out of my head right now. Insecurity. Come on. But there it is right there. Come out right now. There he comes. There he is right there. Sweet Holy Spirit, move on this man of God and give him his healing ministry. Healing in Jesus' name. Satan, lose your hold on me. Come on now. Kick that door in. You got to pray hard. You got to push your way in. My God, help me. My God, help me. Save me. What's wrong with you, hon? What's wrong with you, sweetheart? Anger, when did it start? What age? Yeah, who abused you? The cousin. Was it verbal or sexual? Was it fondling or intercourse? Both. What was his name? Lance? Okay, close your eyes. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you see this beautiful woman here? She picked up a rejection demon from Lance when she was little. He had sexual perversion demons, and some of his spirits transferred in there. And they're torturing her to this day. Lord, I wish Lance was here right now so he could We would pray for him and we would forgive him. And we would ask you to bless him. We would ask you to have mercy on him. And we would forgive him. And tonight, Lord, all these sexual perversion demons from Lentz, he stole her virginity. He stole her innocence. And it wasn't Lentz, it was a spirit. A spirit told him to target her. And then he told her to live with insecurities, low self-esteem, low self-concept, and to use food as a comfort. And spirit, she binds you right now in Jesus' name and commands you, Lentz, come out of there right now. Take a breath and blow. Lentz, come out. Come on out. Lentz, come out of there. Come out now. Every demon from that perverted cousin, come out now in Jesus' name. I will forgive every ugly man that ever touched me. I will forgive myself for being promiscuous. I will forgive myself every spirit of lust that transferred into my body from all these ugly men. I want all of them out in the name of Jesus. All of them out. Come out of me now in the name of Jesus. I command you, spirit, get out of my body right now. Tell him to go. Come out of my body right now. Come out of that body quickly. Come out. Come out. Keep going. Come out of that body right now. Satan, loose your hold of her. Satan, loose your hold of her. Get out of my body right now. Lance, you come out now. Come out right now. Lance, get out. Come out of there. Come out of my body right now. Thus saith the Lord. He got molested. Get out of that body right now. Satan, loose your hold. Now, who hurt you when you were young?
My mother's boyfriend, Prentice.
What did he do to you?
He would touch my butt, and he would, like...
Is he still alive?
I think so.
All right. Lord Jesus, I want you to go find Prentice right now. I want you to go hunt him down. I want you to forgive him. I want you to tell him that I forgave him. And I want all the demons he put into my body out tonight. There he is right there. Come on. Come on up. Here he comes. Come out of there. Come out of her. You unclean spirit. Come out of that body right now. You demon of food, I bind your power. Come out of her. You demon of fear, come out of that body right now. Anxiety, come out. Every spirit from him, I command you to leave that body right now. Come out of my body right now. In Jesus' mighty name, I command you to go. Command you to come out right now. Get at it, girl. Get out now. Get out right now. Get out of my body. You demon of food, go. Come out of there right now, quickly. Yes, atta girl. Get out, get out, get out. Come out. Get out, come out. Satan, get out of my body right now. Every negative thought, every lie. There it is. Every lie. Every negative thought about myself. I repent of it. This has got to stop now. There it goes. Come out of there right now. Go. Every ugly man after him that ever touched my body. All the adultery, all the broken promises, all the users the demon sent me, all these men, go. Every one of these ugly men have got to go. What's wrong with him?
He has a lot of mental stuff going on, and he has heard demons or things like that.
What's the diagnosis?
He doesn't have one. He goes to a Christian therapist. And this is his first time coming here.
Oh.
And,
is he scared?
Well, probably not believing that Christians can have demons.
Oh, okay.
Oh, I'm not sure. No. Oh, really? No, he's the one that needs prayer.
Yeah. Now, I need to help you.
Help me.
Yeah. Yeah, he's not going to get healed.
Right.
He's not going to get healed.
Right.
You got to go first.
I've already gotten deliverance.
Okay.
You've actually already prayed over me.
Yeah. Now, I know. In here, you love him.
I do.
And there's fear in there about his future and what in God's name is going to happen to him as he continues to get worse and what's going to happen to him down the road.
Yeah, I have those thoughts. I've heard what you've said about all this, the fear and doubt, and I've been repenting and releasing that to the Lord. You know, like, it was a miracle that we're even here today.
Uh-huh.
Like, I didn't even think he would want to come. We weren't even planning. I was happy on the couch, and then I was like, oh, it's Friday night. Will you go with me to the Arizona Deliverance Center? I'll drive. And this is not it. He came. So at least, I've been trying to get him to come for 2 years now.
Now, can you sense how you feel right now?
I feel anxious.
Hmm? Anxious, yeah. Anxious. Anxiety.
The thing is, I know that if I could get him here, you know, it's like what you were talking about. I'm desperate. And you've been watching him for the last 2 years go downhill.
Yeah. Good girl. Raise your hands now. Thank you, Jesus. Father God, all this anxiety and this tension is coming up right now. Spirit, I command you to come out of this mother right now. You're blocking her son's healing, and you must come out in Jesus' name. She has to repent of it. Lord Jesus, I repent of anxiety and fear. Come out. Come out of me. Come out of me. Come out right now. Come out. There it is. Keep coughing. They're coming out now. There it goes. Keep coughing. Come out. There it is right there. Keep coughing. Come out. Come out. There they go. Satan, come out of her. Demons, come out of her right now. Every demon from her son, come out. Come out right now. Every spirit from his dad, come out right now. Come out of her. Anxiety. There it is. Keep coughing. Satan, loose your hold. Satan, loose your hold. Satan, loose your hold. Hold that. Come out right now. Go. Come out right now, quickly. Come out of her body. Come out of her muscles. Tension, come out of her. Come out of her stomach right now. Come out. Come out quickly. Quickly. Fear and anxiety. Come out in Jesus' name. Worry. Come out of there. Come out right now. Trying to fix my son. I repent of it. I repent of trying to fix my son. I'm actually keeping him sick. I repent of it right now. I repent right now. I repent right now. I repent right now. I repent. Anxiety. Come out of my muscles. Come out of my muscles. Come out of my muscles. Come out in Jesus' name. There it goes. There we go. Good. Good, 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 good. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Come out in Jesus' name. Come out in Jesus' name. You get out of my body right now. Hey, will you help with this guy? Satan, I command you to come out of him. Come out of the body right now. Evil and wickedness and witchcraft and sorcery. Come out of there, you homosexual spirit. Come out of the body right now, you pedophilia. Get out of my body right now. I'm not going to keep demons in anymore or make excuses for them anymore. I'm not going to put my son ahead of me anymore. Come out, Satan. There they come. Keep coughing. Come on out. Get out of that body right now. Satan, loose your hold of the man of God. You let go of him right now. Satan, loose your hold of him. Quickly. Quickly come out. Quick, 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 quick. Get out. Get out of my back. I told you to come out. Satan, loose your hold of me. Satan, loose your hold of me. Come out of there. Come out of that body. Come out right now, quickly. Come out quickly. I command the spirit to loose my son now. Come out, you filthy devils. Come out of my body, you lying spirit. Come out of my stomach right now. Come out of my vagina. Come out right now. Go now. Poison in Jesus' name, come out. Poison, come out of there. There it goes. Here it comes. Here it comes. Here it comes. Here it comes. You get out of that body right now. And don't you come out slow. You come out quickly. Quicker. Thank you, Jesus. Heal, Lord. Heal. Heal. You demon of fear, you come out of her tummy right now. Come out. There he is right there. Come out. Come out of there. Right now. Come out right now. Come out right now. Quickly. Come out of her tummy, you demon of fear. Come out right now. Low self-esteem, anxiety, come out. I command every ugly man that ever touched her to come out now. All the bad men, all of them, come out. All the bad men, come out right now. I'm releasing my son to the Lord. I'm letting him go. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean to your own understanding. Casting all our care upon him, for he cares for you. I release my son now. Get out of my body right now, you spirit of fear. I want you out now. Come out now. There he is. There he is. Come out of her throat. Come out of that throat. There he is. Come out, spirit, quickly. Come out quickly, spirit. Come on out. Come out of there. Come out right now. Come out right now. Hey, what's wrong with that guy? What's wrong with him? Come on. What's wrong with him? What's wrong with him?
Spirit of anger, rage. Anger. What else?
Come here. Hey, now, you can start getting mad at what age? Come out of there. What age? What age you start losing your temper? How little were you?
I was about 10 years old.
8? And then who hurt you?
Honestly, it was my mom.
Your mom did?
Yeah.
Was it physical or verbal? Come out. Verbal. Was she hard on you?
Yeah.
Was she criticizing you all the time?
Yeah.
What was her name?
Terry.
Terry?
Yeah.
Terry? Okay. Close your eyes. Is your mother still alive?
Yes.
You stay right here. Okay. Father God, in Jesus' name, I want you to hunt down Terry tonight. I want you to tell her that her son totally forgives her. Completely. He didn't understand that his mother had demons. He didn't understand that she was hurt long before he was born and that she had nobody to help her. And she was a very wounded person. And that's why she kept saying negative things. And that's why she was so hard on him. Because she was hurt and nobody helped her. And the devil told her to criticize her son. There he is. So he would pick up fear demons. Here he comes. And tonight, every demon from his mother comes out. Get out of the body right now. Hurry up. Come out, Satan. Keep coughing. Come out of that body right now. Take a cough. Come out right now. Come out right now. Come out right now. What's your name? Sean, what do you need tonight? What's wrong with you?
Like depression and violence and all sorts
of things. Oh. Are you a Christian? No. How can you be depressed and violent if you're a Christian? Demons.
Huh?
Demons. They're violent. They're hateful, and they make people depressed. You ready to repent? Oh, good. Here you go. Raise your hands. Dear Lord Jesus, I am so sorry that I'm living in sin, and I am serving Satan. I am asking you to forgive me for what I have done and all the pain I caused my mother. All the sorrow and pain I caused my mother worrying about me. I am so sorry that I claim to be a Christian and do not live like one. And I'm repenting tonight because the Bible says if I repent, I can receive the Holy Spirit and I can be healed. But if I continue to live in sin, the devil will keep me the rest of my life. Come out of there. Don't stop coughing. Come out. Come on out. And tonight I'm asking you to forgive me. Help me. God, I'm so sorry. I'm sorry for my sin. Come out of that body right now. Come out of that body right now. Quickly, come out of that tummy. Come on out of there right now. Every fear spirit. She got fear demons. Evil, wickedness, and sin. I command it to come out of me. In the name of Jesus. I want this curse broken off of me. Thus saith the Lord, thou shalt not dishonor thy mother or thy father. And I dishonored my mother, and I'm repenting of it tonight to get this curse broken off of me. I need a curse broke off of me. Is curse. I got a mother curse on. Come out of my body right now. I break this curse off of me right now in Jesus' name. The curse of sin. Sin and evil. Anger. Depression. Disobedience. Rebellion. Keep coughing. Come out of that body right now. Quickly. Hurry. Come out of that body right now. God, forgive me. Touch him, Lord, right now. Touch him with conviction. I am so sorry I lived a sinful, demonic Christian life. God, have mercy on me. Cursing, swearing, anger, depression. Lord God, save me. Lord God, save me. Lord God, save me. Lord God, save me. I told you, if you let him go, God will heal him. If you keep worrying about him, he's done. God, forgive me, Lord. God, have mercy on me. Holy Spirit, cleanse my body, oh God. Cleanse my mind, oh God. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry, Lord. Let your tears go. Hurry. The Holy Ghost all over you right now. The Holy Ghost all over you. Come out of there, Satan. Satan, loose your hold of him. Spirit of heaviness, come out. Depression, go in Jesus' mighty name. Go in Jesus' mighty name. Come out in Jesus' holy name. Get out of that body. This guy got anger demons. Come out of that body right now. I see you looking at him. You don't think I see things? I see you looking at him. I saw you looking at him. I saw the look on your face. That's supposed to come out. All of it. 100% of it. Not 80% of it. I saw you looking at him. You had anxiety on your face. Now, get out of that body right now. You get out of that body. You're supposed to go home healed tonight. That's God's will. You're his girl. Don't you understand that? You're his girl, sweetheart. Satan, loose me right now. Fear of my son, go. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. Just tell him you're sorry. Just repent. If you tell him you're sorry, the Holy Ghost will jump all over you. There you go. Good. There you go. Good. Good. Boom. Boom. The Holy Ghost is moving. When the Holy Ghost moves, anything can happen. Anything can happen. But you got to make your move. You got to make your move. You got to move. You get out of my body right now. Did you hear me? I want every spirit from my son out of me right now. I've been working with him for years. I am a worn out mother, and that's a sin. I repent of it. There you go. Come out, Satan. There you go. Good. Beautiful. God's healing your son right now. Don't you see it? Come on, Mama. Repent. Come on, Mama. Father God, give her the Holy Ghost. Heal. There it is. Keep coughing. Go, go, go. Keep going. Make your move now. The Spirit of the Lord is moving right now. Make your move now. Come on, make your move. Biazo. Biazo. What's wrong with you?
I got floating in my stomach.
Was that from a transfer or what? Well, what caused that?
I don't know. What could it be? Stomach is like hard.
Well, he knows something we don't. What is it? He knows something we don't. What is it? Come out of there quickly. Yeah. Lord, tell her what it is. You come out of that body right now. I told you, come out. There he is. Come on out. There he goes. Come out of there now. Got you. I got you. Got you. Come out of that body right quicker. Come out of there right now. Every demon from his father, come out of that body right now. His dad, come out. His grandparents, come out. Every spirit from the grandparents, go. Yeah, body right now. Come on, come out right now. Go, go, go. Go, 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 go. Go, 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 go. Go, go, go. Go, go, go. How you feeling?
New.
What?
New.
New. Okay. It's praise time. You ready? It's praise time. You ready? Go. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Keep going. Making praise. Yo, get out of there. Hey. Did your cousin come out of there? Did he come out of there? Did he come out of there? Lots of stuff yet? All right. Ready? Satan, I command you to stop feeding her. I know what you're doing. You want her to have diabetes, high blood pressure, and have a heart attack. That's what you're doing. I command you to stop it. Stop. Stop. I command this weight to come off. Come off that body right now. Come off. Let go. You're not going to cause her to die when she's 55 years old. No! Stop it. Stop it, I said. Stop. Stop tormenting her. Stop it. In Jesus' holy name. Stop. Come off. Come off. Come off. Come off. Heal. 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 You speak in tongues? Go ahead. Louder. 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 More. Kundra moshandra vashida. Velo moshamba. Good girl. Louder. There you go. Holy Ghost, come in. Yondoro moshanda. Atta girl. Speak it out. Speak it out. Come out. Louder. Atta girl. Atta girl. Satan, come out. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You got a miracle tonight, son. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for healing me. Thank you for healing me. You speak in tongues? You speak in tongues?
I haven't really ever.
Okay. Just follow me. Ready? Boya basha. Ke lo sati. Bekoba. Andoria. Okay? See how easy you were saying that? Then let's try it again. And this time, you add some syllables on your own. Ready? Kurashava. Velo shadre mosha dafa. Belo bashite me. Urara Mashandri Moshata. Hello Shatri Moshandada. Holy Spirit, come in. Holy Spirit, come in. Indora Mama Mashandoro Shandrira. Velo Vashandra Shamashe de Bebe. Hello Mashava Vashandarobo. Good. Any syllable. There's no wrong answer. Purla Baba Bashanda. There you go. Good, good. Good, good. Keep going.
Power and authority to cast out demons, to heal the sick. I swear the gospel right now. And the power of
the minister. But you got a new minister?
Leave my body right now. Spirit of doubt and fear. Leave your body right now. Use your power and authority. We have it. You're born again Christian, right?
I am
you
a born again Christian.
You believe in the book of Acts, right? And use your power and authority. Yes.
He got a miracle. He got a miracle because you let him go. Tell him to apologize to her. Come on, buddy. Stomach right now. Come up, you filthy pig. Heal in Jesus' mighty name. Heal. Heal. Every ugly man that ever touched any part of my body, I release now. I let my husband's demons leave now. All my husband's demons, all of his mental problems, all of his rebellion and disobedience, I let it go. Lord Jesus, I give you my husband. I ask for his healing and I hand him to you. In Jesus' holy name, come out. Come out of there. I let him go right now. Let him go. Come. I let him go right now. Let him go now. Get out of my body. Every ounce of poison. Come up. Every ounce of poison. Adultery and fornication. Any oral sex. Come out of my mouth right now. Oral. Come on. Come out of there right now. Oral sex I took. Come out. Every ugly boyfriend I had in the past that used me, lied to me, cheated on me. Come out. Come out there, you cheater. Right now. Let's go. Let's go. There it is. Keep coughing. Come out. Keep coughing. Atta girl. Keep coughing. Go. Go, Satan. Come out. Come out. Come out. All sorrow. There it is. Keep coughing. Fear and sorrow. Come out of me. Come on out. Get out of there. Come out, you filthy pig. Go. Worry and fear. I command you to come out of my body right now in Jesus' holy name. Worry and fear. Fear of my future. Fear of my relationship. Come out in Jesus' name. Come out of there. Come out of me right now. Fear of my future. Go. Fear of poverty. Out. Go. Come out of there. You stinking pig. Come on. Get out of that body right now. Come out of that body right now. Hurry up. Get out of there. Who needs to be healed? Come on down here. Got something wrong with your body? Come down here right now. Anybody need to be healed? Anybody? Dear Jesus, have mercy on me. Forgive me for getting angry and frustrated. Oh, sweet Jesus, help me. Oh, God, help me. Please forgive me for doubting and losing my faith. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Oh, help me, Lord. Good girl. Let your tears go. Come on, sweetheart. The Holy Ghost all over you right now. Let's go. The Holy Spirit all over you. Atta, girl. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, will you pray for this gal? She got fear demons. Just hold your hand there. Don't touch her. Go ahead. Spirit of fear, I command you in the name of Jesus. Come out of this woman of God. Come out of this woman of God right now. Spirit of fear, go. Go. Get out of my stomach. I told you to get out of there. Come out of there. Every demon in that wheelchair, come out of my body right now. Wheelchair demons, come up. The wheelchair, the symbol of failure. Come out, Satan. Come out, failure. Years of wheelchairs. Oh my God, no. I release you now. I release you now. Thank you, Jesus. Spirit, come out. Spirit, come out of there right now. Spirit, you can't stay there. You can't stay there. How'd it go?
Going well. Thank you.
Did you forgive your mom?
I do.
Oh, good. See, your mom was wounded before you were born.
Right.
The devil beat the crap out of her. And so the symptoms of that were what you got stuck with. They told her to trash you. And she couldn't stop it because she didn't have anybody to help her and she was wounded. If you went back in her life, some bad things really happened to her. And so it manifests in criticism. And the devil says, hey, now you, we got you. I want you to trash him. Right. Now he's got two. That's how it works.
Spirit that makes us want to take advantage of somebody.
Spirit of what?
What would be the name of the spirit? How do we cast out the spirit that makes us want to take advantage of somebody weaker than us?
Take whether advantage, is that what he said?
Or somebody older, or say a homeless person. Is there such a thing as a spirit that wants to overpower, take advantage of other people? Is there a spirit or that's just a flesh?
No, I think all the demons have that. They're all control freaks. Well, who has that demon? Who are you talking to? Talking about?
Oh, I'm talking about
you. What do you? What's your problem? What's wrong with
Lenny.
You, Lenny? Yeah, Mike?
Just been a.
What's wrong with you?
Sex addict a long time.
Yeah, this is, no, taking now, listen. Sex addiction is not the problem. It's never the problem.
Right.
That's a symptom of it.
Yeah.
So to get the person healed, you have to go to the root of the problem. Okay, so you started masturbating at what age?
5 years old.
5, okay. Now, if a kid's masturbating at 5, that's an indication that the demons are already in the family tree. So my guess is either his dad or his granddad or somebody had lust problems. Did they?
Yeah, my grandfather.
What was wrong with him?
Well, he had an affair.
Okay. Now, so what happens is demons come down the family tree, like your case. This grandma or grandpa, whatever, whoever busted your mom up, they come down the tree. He got hit with a lust demon 5 years old. It had nothing to do with him, and he wasn't at fault. It came from grandpa. He was an adulterer. So they came down the tree and then, hey, here's, pick him off. Then he starts developing lust problems. See? And by the time he was 7, he was physically and mentally sexualized. And that's abnormal for a kid that's 5 or 6 or 7. That's not normal. That's demonic. That's not normal and it's not him. So what you got to learn to do is separate yourself from the spirit. This is you, and that's the spirit. They're two different persons. So the way to keep the guy addicted is to treat him. Which is what the demons want you to do. Fix him. He's got the problem. You gave him the problem. He was five. See that? That's how it works. The only way for him to get healed is to turn on him. You got to turn on him. Here's you, here's him. If you turn on him, he'll come out. They came out of him. Didn't you see that? What were you thinking when they were coming out of him? What were you thinking? When you were watching him, what were you thinking?
I'm afraid that it's going to come out.
Oh, yeah.
What did he say?
Just a spirit of fear and doubt, but I saw it coming out.
Yeah. See, now, so he can't get delivered because he's got fear and he's not doing anything about it. You were doing something about it. Did you notice that? He was trying to get him out. He was standing back, collating. See the difference?
Yeah.
He's stuck and you're on your way. If I could get him over to your side here, that five... When he was five, that guy is still in there. He was only five when he got in. No kid masturbates at five. That's totally abnormal. That's not normal human sexuality, a five-year-old. Okay, that's spiritual. And it came from his granddad. It wasn't his fault. He didn't do anything wrong. Five-year-olds are innocent. They're not at fault for anything. Right? He wasn't at fault. His mother was criticizing him when he was little. He wasn't at fault. But now you're at fault. Now you're an adult. So then God then requires you to be responsible. Yeah? So you just close your eyes like that, see? Father God, I ask you to forgive me for letting this spirit stay in my body all these years. He got in when I was five. 5 years old, he turned me into a pervert. He became obsessed. I became obsessed with sex. And it was all abnormal. It was all satanic. And I don't want to ever end up like that guy on the floor screaming there. I don't want to end up like him. I want this pervert out of my body in the name of Jesus. And this is the dispensation of grace. And I can have a miracle if I'll fight for one. You spirit of perversion, five-year-old kid, that's malicious. That's malignant to take a five-year-old and turn him into a pervert. That did it. I hate you. I want you out of my body in the name of Jesus Christ. You come out right now. You get out of my body right this second. Come out of there, you pervert. I'm not the pervert you are. Yeah, you got to hate him. Help him. You got to hate him. You got to hate him. Saints of God, you got to hate the devil. You got to hate him. Okay? Jesus said, you cannot serve two masters. You must hate one of them. You must hate one of them. If you don't hate the devil, he will destroy you. Because he hates you. You are a hated person. YouTubers. Nobody's listening to me anymore. I'll go to YouTube. YouTubers, you are a hated person. The devil hates your guts. And if you don't hate him back, he will destroy you. You will die of diabetes and a heart attack and cancer. You will die ugly. You will die before your time. Jesus said you cannot serve two masters. You must hate one of them. And tonight, we have decided to hate sin and Satan. For thus saith the Lord, we are to hate what God hates, we are to love what God loves. And tonight, I will fulfill my destiny and receive the gift of hate. I receive the gift of hate. Hate for sin, hate for sickness, hate for the devil, hate for wickedness, hate for transgressions, hate for lies, hate for drugs, hate for alcohol, hate for perversion, hate for porn. I hate it. I hate it in Jesus' name. I hate it, I said. I hate it in Jesus' name. I hate it. If you don't hate it, you're going to lose. You gotta hate what God hates. And you gotta love what God loves. If you don't do that, the devil will continue to hate you and kick your face in. Do you like your face? You're not gonna have it much longer. He's gonna kick your face in. He's gonna steal all your money. He's gonna steal your relationships. He's gonna steal your peace. He's gonna give you insomnia. You are gonna live a miserable, stinking life. Paul said in Romans, you are the slave of the master you serve. If you listen to the devil, if you listen to the devil and you do what he says, you are his slave. You must rebel. You must fight. You must repent. You must go back. The kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. By force, they snatch it. They fight for it. You are not going to get healed at your church. Your church cannot help you. You are not going to get healed at your church. Your church doesn't understand. This is a war. This is a war for your life and your soul. And if you don't understand that, you are going to lose. I guarantee it. Just pretend I'm a prophet. Okay? Brother Mike's a prophet tonight. I'm prophesying. If you don't get the gift of hate and you don't repent of your sin, you are going to lose. You are going to lose. I'm warning you. I'm warning you. You've been warned. You are going to lose. There is no way to win. No way. There is no way to win. You must change. You must repent. And you will be healed and you will be delivered. Because this is the new covenant with better promises. This is the new covenant. You get healed and delivered in the new covenant. You didn't get that in the old covenant. The old covenant has been replaced by the new one. This one has mercy. This one has mercy. Mercy's available. Push your way in and come get it. Does anybody need... Love you.
Love you.
Yeah, go ahead.
Mike, right?
Mike, yeah, pleasure.
You know, I think the only time I ever experienced something like this, I was alone in my apartment. It was right before I got married. I was struggling with still porn addiction, going back.
Well, that's him.
Going to prostitutes.
At 5 years old.
But I felt what I'm seeing. I had that day.
Oh, good. That's God reaching out to you. It's a mercy covenant now, not the law. God's trying to help you get delivered. He wants you free.
Is that what that was?
Mm-hmm. Love. God's trying to help you. But you've got a rack of demons in there, and they've all gone dormant. They hide. When you start at 5, they stack up. But once they're out, no more addiction. It's gone.
When you put your faith in Christ and repent, right?
Yeah, and then you
said it in the beginning, right?
Yeah, exactly. And then you take your authority and command them to come out. See this guy here? He's got 10 times more demons than you do. So it's going to take him a long time to get the layers out. Some of them are coming out now, but he's got racks of them in there. So you got to start somewhere, like that guy did. The guy in the plaid, he started here. He's not done, but he was only doing a great job over there. They were coming out. They were coming out, all these people. You saw them all down there. Yeah, you're next. Because God's got a call for your life. You have to fulfill it. But you can't fulfill it with them in there. It's not going to happen. They'll kibosh everything. They'll cause you to relapse. That's their number one thing. Alcohol, drugs, sex, all of it. Pot. They all relapse. Everybody. Because they're doing it. They're powerful. As you know. They give people overwhelming urges. Just unreal. It's like, it's not you. And it isn't you. It's them. It's kind of like a monster movie. See that kid right there? That's not him. It's kind of like the movie The Exorcist. You ever see that movie?
Yeah.
That wasn't her. That was him. This is not you. That's him. Now, you're not near as bad as she was, but same principle. She played with the Ouija board and he got in. You got in. That guy cursed his mother, yelled at her, started blowing the stack. They got in. Yeah, sin gets them in. They come in through sin. Only in your case, it was granddad's sin. Sinning, boom. You were just five. You weren't sinning. Kids don't sin. They're just kids. They don't know what they're doing. Do you speak in tongues?
No.
Oh, okay, so that's your next step.
I don't know if that's my gift.
Yeah, everybody has it. If they're born again, everybody has it. They have the Holy Spirit. Are you saved?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
How do you know? No, he died for everybody. That doesn't mean you're saved. How do you know you're saved?
You know what? I don't know. I have to self-examine.
Do you have any spiritual evidence you're saved?
I don't look at you. I don't look at life the way I used to.
You've improved. You've improved. Okay. Well.
But only because of him.
Okay. Yeah, hold on a second. All right. Now, your salvation is kind of weak, okay? So let's ask God to fix that, okay? Father God, you see this kid here? He's intelligent. And he's street smart, too. He looks around. He reads people easy. And he has great potential to be a minister or a counselor. Something like that. Really good with people. Everybody likes him right after they meet him. But he needs the Holy Ghost. He needs the Holy Spirit. At a greater level than he has now. He needs the anointing. He needs the anointing. So I'm asking you, lead him through it. Lead him into it. All right, take a big breath there. Breathe and heal. Okay, again. Lord, heal him. Heal this man of God. Heal him, Lord. Heal him, Lord. Breath, relax. Thank you, Jesus. Heal, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Heal. I need a visitation, Lord. A visitation upon the man of God. I know you want to use him. Help him. Help him, Lord. Heal. Remoshandra vasha defa. Oremosha vasa. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I want you to fill him with a gift of praise tomorrow, so he's grateful all day tomorrow. Starting right now. Go ahead. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I'm not dead and I'm not in hell. Thank you, dear Lord. I love you. Tell him you love him. Go ahead. Thank you, Jesus. Hi, baby. Hi, sweetheart. How'd you do tonight? What'd she do?
We were praying.
Yeah, I saw that. Well done.
My coming out is pain in my right lung.
Uh-huh.
I think it has something to do with the blood clot I've been dealing with.
You got a blood clot? How long you had that?
Quite a while.
You have?
Yes.
How'd you get it?
Last year I wasn't very mobile, and I almost died from it.
Where is it at?
In this area of my lungs.
There's a blood clot in there? Okay. All right, Lord, I want you to dissolve this thing right now. Dissolve. Heal. Thank you, Jesus. Go. Go. No doubts. And no, come out of there. Come out right now. Come on, buddy. There it comes. Blood clot, come up. There it is. Ah, that's the pain. Spirit of infirmity. Come out of that blood clot. There it comes. Hurry up. Come on out. Get out of there. Get out of there. Come out of there. Get out of that, buddy. Come out of there, stinking blood clots. Come out. There, demon of pain. Come out. There it goes. Come out of that, buddy. Quickly. Quicker. Quickly. Come out. Get out of her stomach right now. Stop causing that pain. There he is. Come on out. Go. Go. Come out. Come out of there. Come out right now. Lift out of there. Let's go. Satan, loose your hold. Get out of that body. Come on out. Get out of that body right now. I command you, Satan, come out of her. Say it. I command you, devil, come out of her. Come out of there. Out in Jesus' holy name. Out, out, out. Out in Jesus' mighty name. I told you to go. Go. Get out of that body right now. Come out right now. Quickly. Hurry up. Get out of there. Satan, come out. Satan, come out.
Get out.
Come out, everybody. Get out of her tongue. She commands you to go and she... Get out of that body right now.
Help
is coming right now. Come out of there. Come out. Get out of the body. There it comes. Thank you, Jesus. Out you go, devil.
I know what it is. It's helplessness. And self and blame or suffering self.
You repented of that 2 years ago.
I know, but like lately I've been seeing like when Pat was like up against a wall, the rain was coming on him and I couldn't do anything to help him.
Those are regrets. Go. Regrets. Pat demons, go. Pat demons still hiding in there after all these years. That's unbelievable. Come on, that body right now. Come out, Pat. Pat, come out. Pat, come out of there. Come out of there. Pat. Pat. It's not her fault. You should have helped yourself. You lied. Come out of there. Get out of there. It's not her fault. You should have helped yourself, Pat. Come out. Come out of there right now. Get out. Get out of there. Regrets over Pat 5 years later. That's outrageous. Come on, buddy. Regrets. Marriage regrets. Come out. Get out of there. Get out of that body right now. Pat, I curse every demon from your body. Come out of there right now. You wheelchair monster. Come on. Come on now. Regrets from her marriage. I can't believe it. Come out of that body right now. You were supposed to have gone 5 years ago. Get out of there. Get out of there. Hurry up. Get out of that body right now. I repent of having regrets over Pat. It wasn't my fault. He should have helped himself. He never repented. He wouldn't repent. He wouldn't change. That wasn't my fault. I release Pat and all my regrets over him. This is my last day to ever be married to Pat. My marriage is severed. Sever. Sever. Severed. Marriage, sever. I sever my marriage right now. Jesus' holy name. Out. This is the end for Pat. Pat goes forever. No more Pat. Pat goes forever. Pat's dead, but he's still alive. He's not supposed to be here. Regrets, marriage regrets. Marriage regrets, unbelievable pain. I release my husband now. I should have done it 5 years ago. This is it. It's over. It's over. I repent of it now. Pat. Pat, roll out of here. Quickly.
Yes.
Pat.
Yes.
Let's go.
Yes.
Come out. I repent of this insanity. The insanity of my husband. Total insanity. YouTubers, this is Brother Mike. I don't know how many of you are listening right now. You probably all went home. It was a wild night. A wild night. The addicts were here. The demon-infected people were here. It was amazing. I hope you can come for a visit soon. Please go to the website, hardcorechristianity.com. Please send me an email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com. Please hit the teaching button and read those two articles, How Satan Controls the Mind. And Satan's counterattack. You will be hit within 48 hours of this service. You will be hit within 48 hours of this service. You've got to be ready for the attack. Every time someone gets a blessing from God, the demons attack shortly thereafter trying to steal it. You've got to be ready for it. Friday nights, Thursday nights, 7 p.m. Mountain Time, right here, our live services. Monday night is our Zoom service for the ladies. Tuesday night is our live service for the ladies here at the Deliverance Center. Wednesday night is our service for men and women on Zoom. All you got to do is send me an email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com. I'll send you the code and the password. And I will see you next time.